So in the beginning of today's program, I would like to invite coordinator of the EUCLIC project, Dr. Bernard Joliet, to address you and introduce you in a glance with EUCLIC project and all activities within this project. Before start, Bernadette, some words about Bernadette. She is a senior scientist in National Institute of Agriculture Research (INRA) in France, in a station located in Louisiana, dedicated to grassland and forage plants. She has devoted most of her research to legume crops, and more specifically to alfalfa. As genetics, her role is to contribute to on identification of relevant breeding tools, traits, to adapt alfalfa crops to the objective of sustainability, forage quality, production, adaptation to mixed cropping with grasses, to improve breeding methods by using of molecular markers, and to cooperate with private sector to ensure application of research by the breeding companies. Since 2017, she is coordinator of EUCLIC Horizon 2020 project. So Bernadette, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you, Dejan. Dear ladies and gentlemen, I'm very pleased to be here and to see this the organization of this training session. So I will directly move to my talk. So I will give an introduction to EUCLIC project. So I'm sorry for EUCLIC participants because it will be more or less the same as already presented. But for all others, I think it's important to that you know about this project. So EUCLIC EU is for Europe, C is for China, and the leg is for legume. And there is a typing error here in the title. So breeding forage and grain legume to increase EU and China's protein self-sufficiency. So we are just at the middle of the project. So we have spent 2 years working on this, and we are still have 2 years. So it's a project granted by European Union, and we answered a call on this subject. So why working on proteins? Because of massive protein imports in Europe and China. Here you can see a graph in Europe. So we are importing in Europe soybean as meal or grains, and the value and the imports are more or less stable over the years, but depending on the price of the proteins on the world market, the value of the imports can vary and tend to increase, as shown by the green line here. So as a total, we have almost 70% protein dependency in Europe, and this ratio is more or less stable. In China, very recently, in fact, the country started importing soybean meal too, and this green line shows that the imports are increasing and increasing. And as a total, some years ago, China imported 60% of the world market trade for protein. So this is the reason why the price can increase too. So we have the same concerns in Europe and China about protein dependency. Most of the proteins come from northern or southern Europe, America. And we don't know in China what the future for dependency. And this can have a major impact. How to produce feed and food proteins? We are speaking here about feed for animals or food for humans. So all plants contain proteins. It's a key component, and the key component is nitrogen. So for the plants, there are two solutions. Either they absorb nitrates that are present in the soil. And why are they in the soil? Because of animal manure, or because of chemical synthesis. And there is a very efficient process, industrial process called Haber-Bosch process, that transforms the atmospheric nitrogen that is present in very huge proportion in the atmosphere. So it's not limited. and then using energy and mainly and almost also only fossil gas, it's transformed into ammonia, and then in the soil it's transformed into nitrate. So this is done in big factories, and yes. And the concern is now the use of fossil energy to produce this reaction. The other solution is to fix atmospheric nitrogen, and legumes are very nice species for that because they are able to establish symbiosis between soil bacteria called rhizobium and their roots. And in fact, the chemical reaction is more or less the same as for the chemical synthesis. The bacteria use atmospheric nitrogen that migrates to the soil and use energy provided by the plant. And with the use of an enzyme, nitrogenase, the atmospheric nitrogen is transformed into ammoniac. And this is the only sustainable way to introduce nitrogen in the agriculture with limited impact on energy consumption and greenhouse gas emission. So greenhouse gas emission could be CO2 because of fossil energy use and and nitrate oxides that have a high level of greenhouse effect. So legumes in agriculture have a major role. So they fix atmospheric nitrogens, and they produce protein-rich products with positive environmental footprints because of energy reduced energy consumption, but other aspects too. And no, it's not my place here to say more about that. So there are two types of proteins of products: either forage with forage legumes, or grain with grain legumes. So forage are mostly used to feed ruminants, marginally monogastrics, so pig or poultry, but it could be used to feed human, in the human diets after protein extracts. But it's at the moment not really used. And grain legumes can be used to feed ruminants too, and for soybean after oil extraction. So the cake is used to feed ruminants. It's then used to feed monogastric animals and also human. So in UCLEG, we are concentrated on 5 species. In fact, they are the species which are the most cultivated in Europe. So 2 forage species, alfalfa or lucerne, and red clover, and 3 grain legumes, so pea, faba bean, and soybean. It's not to say that the other species are not important. They are important, but we had made this choice to concentrate on these species. So the topic is really, the objectives are to increase protein production. So to do that, we have many things to do. To finally produce feed and food, protein-rich feed and food. So we have to improve yield potential and stability. We have to improve adaptation to different stresses, biotic stresses, climatic stresses, abiotic stresses, climate change, and to improve the quality that can be seen as protein content, of course, protein quality for grain legumes, and reduce anti-nutritional compounds, depending on the species. To achieve this objective, we are working on a large set of genetic resources from Europe, of course, from China, and from Americas and elsewhere, and Oceania, but also on elite material, because we are on species that have been bred, and we have some good material in the different countries. So our project is based on phenotypic evaluation, of course, that is a basic work for breeders, but also on the use of molecular markers, and we would like that it's possible for breeders to use molecular tools as much as possible for breeding, for legume breeding. In the project, we are giving efforts on forage species because these species produce more proteins per hectare than grain legumes. They provide more ecosystem services and they were less covered by EU research actions in the past. So the objectives of UCLEG are, there are three categories. The first one at the scientific level is to broaden the genetic base of legume crops and analyze the genetic diversity of European and Chinese legume accessions using phenotypic traits and molecular markers. Also to analyze the genetic architecture of key breeding traits using association genetics and more specifically genome-wide association studies. And we have target traits defined by the participants as the most important ones. And we want to evaluate the benefit brought by genomic selection to create new legume varieties. At the technological level, we have some issues too, so some objectives. We are developing searchable databases containing passport data as well as agronomic and genetic features to be able to look for genetic resources and also to develop molecular tools and data that are needed for molecular breeding. And at the applied level, and in our case, applied level is breeding, we are developing tools for genotyping because we had not enough markers and genotyping methods for all the species at the moment or before the project. To implement data management and analysis, it's not only the fact to collect data, but we need to be fluent for data management and analysis. And also, it's a minor point, explore the potential of new uses of forage species for animal nutrition. So the project is organized into work package. I'm not spending too much time on that, but briefly, there is a work package on molecular markers and genotyping, in fact, of the population used in the project. There is a work package on the genetic resources and database. We have two work package on phenotyping and one package devoted to phenotyping, including one package for GWAS analysis and one package for genomic selection. And the arrows here show the flux of information from one package to the other one. And of course, we have training and dissemination, training and exploitation, and this training takes place in this work package, and we have a management work package. And an important thing is to see that we have some flux of information. So we have accessions here, genetic resources, varieties. We are phenotyping them. We have genotyping on this accession, and everything goes to a database and are exploited through the use of a software called Progeno that should make easier all data analysis, and then we produce some results about genetic diversity, genotype, cross-environment interaction, the structure of the population, so genome-wide association studies and genomic selection. So, yeah. So, some important points about the project. We have the same strategy for all five species, and this is very important, so it's the use of genetic resources, phenotyping and genotyping of these populations, accessions. We are focusing on key phenotypic traits, going from the establishment of the crop to yield and quality, and including resistance to stresses. We are describing genetic variation and by E interactions, genetic architecture of the traits, and we are developing a software for data management analysis. In this project, we have a strong collaboration with private companies because several companies are partners of the project. So to make sure that our results are used, are made by public and private companies, our institutions, and used in breeding program. Our partnership is quite wide with partners all over Europe, more or less. The dots here are for the field experiments, but there are other experiments in control conditions that are not mentioned here for the five species. And we have 12 Chinese partners working on alfalfa and soybean. And yeah, so there are, and some of Chinese colleagues are here, and we are very glad about that. So dissemination is scheduled, of course, in this project. So for the publication, we have you have made an arrangement with one specific journal, scientific journal, called Frontiers in Plant Science. I think you all know it. And we have defined a research topic in which most of UCLEG publication will be published in. So it means that if you want to see our progress into publication, you will have to look at this issue. Newsletters are sent every 6 months to stakeholders. So if ever you haven't received yet some newsletters from UCLEG, you can register on the list and send an email to Marie Kubenkova, who was here just a minute ago. We have a website that you can have a look on. And we are organizing training towards breeders, scientists, students. So this one is the training dedicated to UCLEG members and other scientists or breeders. So the training is also yes, there is a streaming organized to follow the lessons here. So I say hi to the person online, and there will be a repository site too. You will have the contribution of 6 experienced lecturers from high-level institutions. So I'm sure you will be happy with the contribution. And I really thank the organization done here, of course, by RIT, but also the organization done by the Institute for Forage Crops in Kruševac, Serbia, and Jan Sokolovic. So I think it's my last slide. So please ask questions if something is not clear during the presentations, and it's important that we discuss and you discuss. And if you have a question, if something is not clear, probably you are not the only person in the room for which it's not clear. So please ask questions. And also take opportunities of the break for discussions between trainees and with the lecturers. So they are just scientists as you are. So I wish you a very good training, and thank you for attention.